Church of World War. Where is it? Where is it? Right there. Served in World War II, Korea, and Vietnam. So. So far, but I can't imagine it's going to be what 2018 was. That was quite a year. Because you, as many of you know, I was running for governor myself. I was running, and you know, we had four people in the race, and came to the point that we were going to have to make this choice about, we're really all four going to run each other and maybe create this situation where we all lost because the Democrats were united and the Republicans were fractured. And Mike DeWine and I had a nice talk, and we decided to team up, and we were running number one and number two in the polls, and just thought that maybe us working together would be better for everybody. And so that's what we did. And that was hard. Tina and I had a hard family discussion, a hard conversation, calling all of your supporters around the state and telling them what you were doing. And really, you know, the days leading up to the announcement, because once you decide to do this, you don't get a lot of time to talk because it'll start to leak out and media will be asking questions and you want to announce it on your own terms. And so we hurried up and we called people and we told them what we were doing. And, you know, there was a lot of tough calls. People have been with you, helping you, doing stuff like that. You don't ever want to let them down. But we did the tour. Mike and Fran, Tina and I did the media conferences, went around. A lot of people were super happy that we were teaming up and we were going to give us a better shot to win this thing as Republicans, governor's race. And so as we were doing this, you know, long day, news conferences, we finally did it through it all, and I get home. Tina knows the story I'm going to tell, that's why she's laughing. I tell my daughters, Katie and Kylie, who were 8 and 11 at the time, I think. I tell them that Daddy is not going to run for governor, he's going to run for lieutenant governor. And Kylie, who's our youngest, she starts crying. I mean, you know, your baby daughter, she starts crying when you're a dad. Like, oh my gosh. You know, everything else went great. It's like when your daughter's crying and she's unhappy with you, it's like everything else didn't matter because she's upset about it. She's just not happy. And I go, oh my goodness, you know. She was inconsolable. She was just weeping, uncontrollable. And she looks at me and she goes, I don't even know what a lieutenant governor does. Like, that's all right, nobody else does either. No. I couldn't get her to stop crying. And finally, I get her to slow down a little bit. And I said, I'm like, honey, talk to me. What's wrong? She's like, Daddy, you promised we'd get a dog if you ran for governor, and now we don't want to get a dog. So that's what it was all about. And then I told her, I'm like, it doesn't matter. We'll get a dog either way. And then, like, the tears go away. She's like, okay, great. That's fine. Whatever. Do what you want. So now I knew how important this all was, really. It was just about getting a dog. And so now we're the proud owner of a blue heeler named Rosie. And now I get bossed around by six girls. Tina, Katie, Kylie, Rosie, Alexa, and Siri. They're all kind of telling you what to do these days. So. But we really appreciate, the governor and I really appreciate your support. It was a tough race, difficult race. And, you know, we're running up to the election. I mean, the last couple months, we didn't take a day off. I mean, it was like every day, 7 days a week. He was somewhere, I was somewhere, Tina was somewhere, Fran was somewhere. We were fighting because, as you noticed, in the last 30 days, it was showing that the polls, all the media polls, said we were going to lose. Said we were behind, we're going to lose. And, you know, you never know what to believe. But the last 30 days, all those public polls said we were behind, we were going to win. So, you know, you don't know. I remember I was talking to my staff, and I just said to some of them who were worried about it, I said, gang, it doesn't matter. I said, you can't control what happens. You can't control what the voters do. That's one of the wonderful things about democracy, is up to them. All we can control is what we do. And this is good advice no matter what you do in life. Just give it your best shot. Give it everything you have, do it the right way, and live with the consequence, and win with dignity, and lose with grace. And you know, that's what you do. And I said, we'll act the same way either way, but we have to do our best. We have to give people the effort that they expect out of us. That's exactly what we did. And it is most times, anytime you do something like that in life, it turns out exactly how you hoped it would. And we were blessed to get a win on election night. It was a great, fun night. Some of you were there for that. We really appreciate that you put into it. And we do feel, anytime you're in a tough race, this is the good part about it, is that you do feel a sense of responsibility to live up to the hopes that people had for you. And that's what we hope to do every single day, is to live up the expectations that you have for us. But I'll tell you, one of the interesting things about the poll numbers and the election night numbers, you know, Ohio was very divided, and very divided in our elections. Even though people will call us a purple state, we have very red places, and we have very blue places. In Hamilton County, Cincinnati, we lost by around 30,000 votes in one county. You may say, wow, that's a lot of votes. But do you know in Mercer County, I know we have some people from Mercer County here tonight, Amy, we won Mercer County by 10,000 votes. And there are only 17,000 voters in the whole county. We got 80% of the vote there. 80% of the vote. Wow. And just I think it was Mercer, Dark, in Miami County, just in three counties, we made up the entire difference of Hamilton County. That shows you the power of what rural counties are doing to overcome what's happening in our urban counties. So that guy standing in the back over there with his thumbs up, he's not going to win without you, that's for sure. And none of us do. None of us do as Republicans in this state. We need your support. We try to honor that support and give you the best possible government that we can provide. And Governor DeWine and I, you know, we've been at it. We've been 105 days into this. Who's counting, right? We have our kids agenda. Truly, we're trying to look at what's best to help kids from pre-birth, as you know, to all the way to kindergarten through school when they get out, helping them get a good start in life. And the DeWine family is committed to that. You know, we have a demographic problem in Ohio, and in many ways that we're losing more of our working age workforce than people are coming in. People are turning 65 faster than they're turning 18. We need to grow our population. I always joke that the DeWines have held up their end of the deal much better than the Husteds. 20, Mike and Fran have 8 children and 24 grandchildren. But we put families, we put kids first, trying to build an agenda that helps lift people up, particularly those who are struggling, our kids, maybe who don't have a good shot in life. And Mike and Fran are great leaders in that respect. Tina and I are trying to do our part. But my role mostly is focused in three areas as Lieutenant Governor. And I love these areas. These are things I've worked on my whole life. These are things I'm passionate about. Economic development, workforce development, and innovation. Technology and how we're going to build a future for the state. How we're going to put Ohio in a great spot. And we did a big announcement yesterday on Innovate Ohio, which is really to make government more customer service friendly, to use data analytics to help make government more accountable, and to do things like data security so that all the information that we have in Ohio, that everybody's identities are protected. You know, with technology, you've got to be very careful about that. My goal for Innovate Ohio, it is really to start treating people like the customers they deserve to be. Government sometimes doesn't treat people right. We don't use technology to make things better. When I was Secretary of State, we used technology to improve everything we did. We made our office so efficient we were able to cut the wait times to start a business in Ohio from 4 days to 4 hours. We made it so efficient that we could cut fees by 21% to start a business, so we had the lowest cost state in the Midwest to start and maintain a business. Over the course of 8 years, we eliminated through attrition and early retirement, 40% of the folks, we eliminated 40% of the bureaucracy. And at the end, we were so efficient that we didn't even need any tax dollars to run our office. And the idea behind Innovate Ohio is making sure that we do that across all state government. You know, I don't think we're going to be able to run all state government without any tax dollars. I'm not overpromising things here, right? But we can get a lot more efficient. We can do that. I mean, think about this. How many of you have ever ordered anything online? Okay? With your phone, your computer, your whatever it is, your mobile device. How many times have you gotten into something where you were trying to do it and it was so cumbersome and difficult you just said, not going to do it? And then how many times did you find something that was so simple and easy and you said, wow, this is where I'm going to go and do my business? That's what we want state government to be. We want state government to treat you just like that, so that we're making life easier for you. My hope is that we will make ourselves so efficient and so technology friendly that you never have to go into another government office ever again. Now, I understand you may enjoy your experience at the BMV. If you want to keep it, we'll leave it for you. Always going to have a paper option for you. But we really think Ohio can be a leader, make it the most innovative, creative state in the Midwest, and that's what we're trying to do. And we're also focused on the workforce, helping people get the skills they need. I'll tell you the other day, there's no more important issue for businesses in the state than workforce. Used to hear it all the time. I remember my early days in politics in Ohio, business would say, taxes are too high, regulations are too bad, might have a workers' compensation issue that they didn't like. Regulation, taxes, that's what our problem is. Over the course of the last 15 years, we've gone through many, many tax overhauls in the state and cut taxes and cut regulations. We're now in the top 15 best states in the country for taxes and regulation for business, which is good news. But now the number one thing I hear from businesses all the time is workforce. Can't find the talent that they need. Can't find the talent that they need. Want to grow the business. Can't find the people that they need. What's workforce mean? It might mean anything from somebody who can pass a drug test and show up 5 days a week. That's workforce. Might also mean somebody who's a PhD geneticist who they need to help solve some amazing come up with some amazing cures for genetic diseases and things like that, which is also happening in Ohio. All of these things are workforce. And the governor and I want to do a great job in helping people throughout that continuum have access to the training and skills that they need so that we can create a great environment for business in the state. And I'll tell you this quick story. I was with got a call from a county commissioner, got some county commissioners in the room tonight, and got a call from one of Ohio's poorest counties. And they said to me, we're very worried that our largest private sector employers are moving to Mexico. So that concerned me, so I get on the phone and I call. And they reassured me that no, we're not moving to Mexico, but we do have some issues we're going to talk to you about. So I sit down with the CEO of this company. And he says, we want to expand. We want to add 200 to 300 jobs. They start out, you know, anywhere around $18 an hour, up to high 20s. Don't require anything but, you know, a high school diploma and passing the drug test, a lot of great jobs. And then some other jobs that are more highly skilled, even pay more than that. So good jobs. But they said that, here's the deal. You have to prove to us that you can supply the talent, because we don't think you can. And if you can't, we're moving either to another state or we're removing our expansion to Mexico. That should happen. You can't let those things happen. And that's And I was doing this today. I'm a big fan of career centers. Been to your local career center lately? Anybody familiar with the career center? High school doing some good things, creating industry credentials. I was in Lyman today at the Apollo Career Center. You go to career centers a lot. Because they're not like what career centers were. Like, usually people think it's like, oh, it's just shop class. No. It's much more than that. Education's changing. The nature of work is changing. You go to your career center today, you'll find robotics. You'll find cybersecurity, coding. Yeah, you'll also find welding and machining and other types of skills. But it's everything. And you can earn college credits when you're there. And I go to these things called signing days at your career centers. Okay? Signing. What's a signing day? Most people, how many Buckeye football fans do you have out there? A couple of those. Okay, now we're talking, right? We got Buckeye football fans. Signing day, I mean, it's people who are follow college football, signing day is like a religious event to them. It's like, who's coming to our school? They're going to sign the scholarship. We're going to get this great person. We go to career centers and do signing days for those kids too. Because it's just because celebrate what you want more of. I understand celebrating a great high school football quarterback is important, but celebrating the kids in high school who are getting industry certifications and earning college credits and going to work right out of high school because they're trained and ready is we're celebrating too, isn't it? She's working on it, and she started it, now she's got through our church, and they're bringing adults from all walks of life in to help these kids that are aging out of foster care, and these young adults just have a shot. And I want you to think about this, because she's told me some great stories about this, and I'll brag on her a little bit. And it's not bragging, it's a testimony. It's a calling when you really dig into this, when you hear from people. That everybody wins when you do this, because here you have young adults who have nobody who really ever cared for them or loved them in their lives, who's really there for them when they needed it. And they're struggling, and they got a lot of baggage that comes with it. And they need some stability, they need some friends, they need some guidance, and that's what these adults are doing. Helping those young people. And Tina started this, and she's trying to spread it throughout Ohio. And Lord knows we've got a lot of kids out there that need help. More young people that need help than will ever find adults to provide them that tape. But the great thing about it is, the unexpected thing is what all of those adults who are around the table get back in return. Because they start to appreciate the blessings in their lives. They start to understand that the world isn't like the world that they live in. They need to be maybe a little more compassionate, a little more caring, a little more understanding when you get to know somebody who's from a different world than you are. Helps people understand each other better, helps them grow closer, helps them understand that we are all united in God's world, and that we got to help one another. And that's what I believe we are as a people, as Americans, as Ohioans, when we're at our best. When we look out for people, we give them opportunity, we give them hope, and we give them a chance. Because in the end, I think that's what everybody wants. They just want somebody to care about them. They want a fair shot in life, and they want their chance to live the American dream. And I really believe that, you know, well, we'll never be perfect at it. That's what Mike and I want to do in our work in state government. That's what Fran and Tina want to do with the blessing that they have and their roles in the administration. And all of you are leaders in your own right. You're here today. And I know I've talked to many of you, I don't know all of you in the audience, I know a lot of you, but there's somebody who looks up to you in the world. There's something that you can change about the world every day. And when we do that, that's the way we make America a better place. And that's the way we create the brighter future and leave, as every generation wants to do, the world a little better place than the way we found it. So God bless you. God bless us all in this journey. And thank you very much for the opportunity to share this story tonight.